So what drives me to make this video? What are my motives? Why am I choosing Spain? It's common knowledge that between 2007 and 2016, the backbone of the Spanish national team was comprised mostly of Barcelona players. You know Xavi, Villa, Puyol, Iniesta, Piqué, and the list continues. All were world-class players. They even played a similar style to that of Barcelona, a dynamic possession-based football where the players moved constantly and even interchanged their positions to confuse the opponents. Compared to Barcelona, Spain was more conservative, especially when they faced defensive-based teams, for the simple reason of not having their special card, Messi. In Barcelona, Messi is and was the guy who solved their problems. He's still their most clutch player. Imagine Messi in Spain doesn't require a lot of brain power or supercomputers or complicated algorithms to visualize how he'll perform or calculate his overall stats with Spain. When 5 to 7 players, sometimes 8, are in the starting lineup of every Spanish game and the playstyle is the same one used in Barcelona, eventually you realize that Messi swapping shirts is like, you know, when Indiana Jones steals a treasure and swaps it with something equal in weight. The difference is his trick doesn't end on a good note, but Messi, it freaking works. It just works. So without further ado, let's visualize and narrate how Messi's national career would have looked like if he chose Spain.
Messi's beginnings.
Before even getting drafted for the senior team, you spent some time in the junior team, the under-20s, the under-70s. Leo with Argentina did win the 2005 World Cup in the Netherlands. To our luck, in the quarterfinals they faced Spain, in which Argentina delivered and won by 3-1. Spain did have some good players. If Messi played with them, they'd have a good chance to win. But I'm no prophet, so I can't really guarantee it. So when did Messi debut with Spain? I presume that it would have happened after the under-70s World Cup in 2005, precisely in the 7th of September against Serbia Montenegro. His first game in an official tournament would have been in the 2006 World Cup in Germany. But to Messi's surprise, he'd only play for a few minutes because of his recent 2-month injury and Luis Aragonés preferring his older players to execute his plans. Unfortunately, Spain's story is cut short in the tournament. Then a few months later, Luis Aragonés refrains on calling Raúl González with a few other players to make up more space for the younger generation. In Barcelona, Messi keeps on surprising the world with his world-class performances, which in return secures him a spot in Spain's starting lineup for the upcoming games. In 2008, after landing in the first spot with 28 points in the qualifiers, Spain are seen as big contenders for winning the trophy this time. No surprise here, Leo and co. obliterate their opponents and win a second Euro Cup for Spain. Now hear me out, Messi winning this trophy might translate to winning the Ballon d'Or. Sure, it depends on how well he performed, but look at the bright side. He could have won his first one at the age of 21. The appointment of Guardiola as the coach of Barcelona in 2008 had a big impact on Spain's football dominance for the next 5 years, but in our case, the next 10 years. 2009 was a big year for Messi, a treble with Barcelona and an overall improvement from last year. We must not forget about the Confederation Cup. In the real world, Spain lost in the semifinals to the United States. They were simply unlucky, and they clearly did not deserve to lose. But this time with Messi, Spain gets the trophy. It's 2010 and Messi wins more trophies and he gets his second Ballon d'Or. Now compared to 2 years ago, Messi's goal scoring stats tripled and fans are really looking forward to how Messi, the goal scorer, is going to perform in this World Cup. In the real version, Spain dominates their opponents and they manage to seal the trophy. And yeah, obviously with the addition of Leo they'd also win, but the general critics often criticize Spain's very low output. You know, their low number of goals scored during the tournament. Only 8 goals. One of the reasons is because they only played with one striker, and Torres was out of form. With Messi, I can see double that number. I also feel like Spain's right side would really benefit of a player of the quality of Messi. He'd probably snatch the golden ball and maybe also the golden shoe. Just another day in the office for Leo. Now, I just want to take a minute and speak my heart out about Del Bosque. I do not rate Del Bosque. In my book, he's the luckiest manager of the 21st century. Now, I'll explain why. Spain was stacked. Before winning the World Cup, half of the players in the starting lineup played in Barcelona. Those players played in the same system for two consecutive seasons. Just imagine Xavi waking up every day, going to training with the likes of Puyol, Piqué, Iniesta, Busquets, every freaking day. Of course, they're winning the World Cup without the need of a great coach. The benefit of having most of them play in the same team is you don't need time to prepare tactically compared with other national teams. Guardiola makes a positive mark on every team he coaches. Coaches Barcelona, Spain dominates. Coaches Bayern Munich, Germany gets that extra push and wins the World Cup. Coaches Man City and England qualifies to the semis for the first time in 28 years. Del Bosque is a bit overrated. When his original plan fails, he usually screws up with some random substitutions and then it's up to his players to win games. Spain's success was due to Barcelona. Leo's trophies and accolades keep on piling up. Now he probably needs another trophy cabinet after winning two more Ballon d'Ors, four consecutive ones at the age of 24.
Impressive.
An astronomical season for Messi, 73 goals in 60 games, his best goal scoring season yet, and with the 2012 Euros on the horizon, all eyes are on Leo. In this tournament, with the injury of David Villa and Torres' inconsistency, in 3 out of 6 games, Spain played with no attackers. 4 defenders, 6 midfielders, 0 attackers. Now listen closely, I've been saying this for more than a year, this is very important. Let's compare Spain and Argentina. Now Spain could have just lined up with 4 midfielders and 2 attackers. But Spain said, no, we're not doing that. We're not benching Fabregas and David Silva or Xabi Alonso for Negredo or Llorente. We're not benching great midfielders for average attackers that will potentially lower the team's overall quality. Oh no, we're not doing that. We use 6 great midfielders who pass well, move well, and can keep possession for 5 minutes straight, and it worked. Obviously. Now we jump to the mess that is Argentina. Everyone knows that Argentina has great attackers, but unlike Spain, they did not focus on building a team around them. You know, Spain built a team around their midfielders, and Argentina did not build a team around their attackers. For example, in 2018, instead of a trio consisting of Messi, Aguero, and Dybala, they used the services of Messi, Acuña, Enzo Perez, and a old Mascherano, and they benched Dybala, and 50% of the games they bench Aguero to create the illusion of balance with having more midfielders than attackers. Eventually, they lost. Spain focused on their strengths. Argentina did not. The Spanish Messi will wreak havoc in Europe. He'll play a false nine role and statistically, he'll score between 6 to 7 goals in the tournament. And he'll go on and win his 5th consecutive Ballon d'Or. 2013 was a sad year. It was filled with injuries for Leo, and even winning the 2013 Federations Cup might still not grant him the Ballon d'Or. It was rigged from the start. Well, in FIFA's book, the Federations Cup is like a friendly tournament. I don't know why, seriously, it makes no sense. The year is 2014. In the real world, Spain was disqualified in the group stages, and Messi went to the final with Argentina. However, if they join forces, they'll go home with a 2nd World Cup. Now, you tell me why, and of course, I'll answer you. Spain's biggest mistake was starting Diego Costa ahead of the likes of Pedro, Villa, and Torres. Back then, Diego Costa was not used to playing the Barca way, or the Spanish way of playing football. He only played 2 or 3 games with the selection, and he basically had no chemistry. His aggressive play style did not suit Spain, so in both the Netherlands and Chile fixtures, he disappeared. Spain's attack was literally non-existent. But with Messi's 2014 World Cup performance in mind, I believe they can do it for the 2nd consecutive time. Just swap Diego Costa with Messi. I know some of you are skeptical, but keep in mind that Spain is basically Barcelona. These players know each other for more than 6 years. They played for more than 300 games together. They simply have more edge compared to the other teams. And we shouldn't forget that international competitions are less tactical than club competitions. Messi will finish as top scorer and he'll win the Golden Ball. 2014 and 2015 were very successful years for Leo. With already 7 Ballon d'Ors in his trophy cabinet, he prepares for his next challenge. the Euros of 2016. If Portugal can win it, if Wales can qualify to the semis, what can possibly stand in the way of a Spanish national team led by Messi? They'll most likely win again. This is ridiculous. If Messi was Spanish, this is how the international football scene would have been like for a decade. A total domination. I'm just gonna skip the 2018 World Cup. They might win, maybe not. It's not even fun anymore. Messi's influence is massive. Give him a solid team that can pass well and get him the ball, and he'll do the business for you. Yet, there's one issue. Something that I haven't talked about yet. There's a possibility that, especially post the year 2014, that Spain might have relied too much on Leo, that their players might start getting lazy and wait for Messi to bail them out most of the time, just like what is happening in Barcelona. If this happens, it will backfire at them, because the good results might not be because of the team's and the coach's brilliance, but one man is behind them. To summarize, Spain would have been Brazil's 21st century, and Messi would have been Spain's Pelé times 2. In a previous video, I asked you about how many goals Messi could have scored if he somehow chose Spain. Well, guess who did the maths? Because Spain is just a stripped-down version of Barcelona, calculating Messi's stats was a child's game. So, I just took Messi's stats with Barcelona in every season, and with the help of a Wikipedia page about Spain's football games since their first match ever, I was able to do it. And the numbers are quite astonishing. For example, if we take his numbers in the 2011-2012 season, he had 1.216 goals per game. We take that number and we multiply it by the number of games that Messi could have potentially had. We find out about his total goals with Spain in that same season. In this case, it was 21 goals. Since Messi's first game in 2005 till the last Spanish game in 2019, Messi's numbers are at 202 games played, 174 goals, and 69 assists. But when we include injuries, the real numbers are at 190 games, 162 goals, and 64 assists. Compared with Argentina, with Spain he had an increase of 39% in games played, 155% in goals scored, and 48% more in assists. I doubt that he'd play 190 games, like maybe 160, 170, and obviously the other stats will also drop. But still, hypothetically speaking, in 190 games, he could have easily scored 162 goals, because of all of the reasons I have previously spoken about. So in summary, he could have amassed more trophies, Ballon d'Ors, 777 goals and 297 assists in 876 games in his career. Just a little bonus, in the 2011 and 2012 season, his total goals would have went from 83 if he played for Argentina to 91 goals if he played for Spain. And his all-time record of 91 goals in 2012 in the calendar year will become 98 goals. Thank you guys for watching. I hope you enjoyed this concept. I have more of these what if videos coming in later months. I also invite you to watch my previous video on a topic that's way more serious about the inception of the UEFA Super League. Thanks for sticking around till the end, and until next week. Ciao.